like? God is still in control, because he says the just shall live by faith. We walk by faith, not by sight. You can't be moved by what you see. You can't be moved by what you feel. You can't be moved by what you hear. You can't be moved by what you think. But you can stand on what you believe. And what you have to believe is the word of God. Glory. Am I making sense to you so far? God is good. By faith, you have to believe that God is good. God is good when it doesn't feel good to your flesh. God is good when it's not comfortable for the things that's coming against you. God is good because of who he is, not because of what's going on in your life. Am I making sense? All right. Let's start at First Thessalonians. It doesn't do anyone any good if at the end of these messages, you can tell me what you get out of them, but you're not able to apply what you say you got out of it to your life. And that's what I want to start off saying. It's a good thing to be able to say, this is what I got out of the message today. This is how the message ministered to me today. But if you're not taking what you're getting and applying it to your life, you're being deceived and you're being deluded. Because if you can't see on the news and in dramas and in your neighbors and the things that's going on in this world that the Bible itself is unveiling right before your eyes, then the God of this world has already blinded you and you just going through the motions. Am I making sense? We're the light. We're the children of God. We're the children of the day. And nothing that is taking place in this earth is supposed to take any of us by surprise. Because we're supposed to stay close to God in his word and through prayer. Am I making sense? 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. God is awesome. And I'm grateful. Even the songs to me goes along with what I feel God is leading me to give to you today. In verse 13 it says, for this cause also we thank God without ceasing. And listen to this. This is a profound scripture. Because when you receive the word of God, which you heard of us, Paul speaking and his people who was following along with him, you received it not as the word of men, but as it is in the truth, the word of God, which effectually works also in you that believe. When you receive the word of God, you don't receive the word of God as though it's coming from a man, but you receive it as though it's the truth. And when you believe it as truth coming from God, it has the word, has the power to work in you, only in those who believe. And right now, when you see the darkness, when you see the evil, you need the word of God to be able to work effectually in you, but it only is going to work in the people who believe. Do you get that? All right. You have to have confidence in God's word. You can't have confidence in your own ability. You can't lean to your own understanding, but you have to have faith and confidence in the word of God, because Jesus is the word is Jesus, and Jesus is truth. All right, are you with me? Drop down to verse 18. This is what you need to know more than anything else. Wherefore, we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again I would have come to you, but Satan didn't just hinder Paul, but Satan hindered us. So a group of people. He was able. He is the God of this world. And you need to not live in a fantasy world. Satan is the God of this world. We live in enemy hostile territory. And he was able to hinder the person who God entrusted with the whole doctrine of grace. Do you see it? Am I making sense? So if he can hinder Paul, you know he can hinder us. Paul saw Jesus Christ. And he had an anointing and revelation knowledge that we don't have. We only can have it as God reveals it to us. Am I making sense? Let's look down then in chapter 3, verse 2. Paul sent Timotheus, our brother and minister of God, and our fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ. We are laborers in the gospel of Christ. And underline, the gospel of Christ is to establish you and to comfort you concerning your faith. You're going to need comforting, and you're going to need to be established, because Satan is going to hinder you and your faith. Do you see it? That no man should be moved by these afflictions. So don't allow your afflictions to move you away from your faith. For yourselves know that we are appointed thereunto. We are appointed to experience afflictions. So if you give up in your times of afflictions, or you allow yourself to be moved when you get hindered by the devil, you already going to be defeated. Am I making sense? For verily or truly, when we were with you, we told you before that we should suffer tribulation, even as it came to pass. And you know, this is where the church has failed humanity, because people been preaching the name of it and claiming and get rich quick type of schemes, and instead of equipping you and preparing you to stand when you get hindered, when you go through afflictions, when you go through tribulations. It says, for truly when we were with you, when Paul was establishing his church, he told the people that you're going to be suffering tribulations. And when they come to pass, you shouldn't be surprised. For this cause, when I, Paul, could no longer forbear, I sent to know your faith. See, this is what all of us should be concerned about. Lest by some means the tempter, underline the tempter. We all have a tempter, have tempted you, and our labor is in vain. You see, when the tempter comes, when trials, when tribulations, when hindrance, when persecutions come, Paul knew the people who he was telling about the gospel, that they could be tempted to move away from their faith. And that's the same thing is happening today. We spend time praying for people. We spend time witnessing to people. We spend time telling people about the Lord. And the enemy is there to hinder the people, to tempt the people. And they might end up defecting. It's a possibility that it could happen to anyone, even back in Paul's day. Is this making sense? Do you see it happening in your own life? You could be tempted. You could be hindered. You could go through afflictions and tribulations. And when you do, the scripture is saying, don't be moved by those things that can come against you. That's where your faith has to kick in. That's where you have to dig in and decide, I'm in this till the end. I believe the word of God. I believe the scriptures is the inspired word of God, and I'm going to regulate and conform and live my life according to it. And I know that whatever trials, whatever tribulations, whatever persecutions, the Lord is going to take me through it. All right? Making sense? Look at chapter 5. Thessalonians is a good book for everybody to get into and really read it and study it. In verse 1 it says, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, you don't need me that I should write unto you about it. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. It comes as a thief in the night for those who are not of the day. But it shouldn't come to us as a thief in the night, because we are connected to God the Father. We are connected to the source of life, to the source of all creation. So nothing should catch us by surprise. We ought to be looking. That's why he's saying, I don't need to write it to you, the times or the seasons. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction come upon them as travail upon a woman with child. And they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, that day should overtake you as a thief. It should not. Nothing we see taking place, nothing the enemy is doing, should be able to take us over. We are not in darkness if we live according to God's standard. If, that's a prerequisite. If you're not doing what you know to do, the scripture says to you, that's sin. You are all the children of light and the children of the day. We are not, emphasize, we are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us, so since you are not of the darkness of the night, don't sleep. Let us not sleep as do others. But underline, and you may already have this underlined. Let us watch and be sober. Let us watch. When you're watching and you're being sober, you are alert. You're paying attention. You're the children of the day. You're not the children of the night. And you need to be prepared spiritually and naturally because you're alert. You're watching. You're paying attention. You're not asleep. You're not hypnotized. You're not brainwashed. You're not programmed by the Antichrist system because you're children of the day. You're not children of the night. You can't be on both sides. You're either on God's side and be children of the day, or you're on the enemy's side. You can't do both. If you're not serious, you're going to be taken over by the darkness. God is going to spew you out. He's going to spit you out. You can't be both light and dark. That's why he gave me the two-sided chart. You can't be on both sides of that chart. You're either on one side or the other side. But God gives you free will for you to choose. He don't make you. He gives you free will for you to choose which one of those sides you want to be on. Now, part of being alert and watchful is keeping up with looking for news, looking for information, paying attention to everything. I have a handout to pass to you. It's 3 pages, so each person make sure you get 3 pages. And we're not ritualistic here. We're going to slow this down a little bit because I get excited. Like, there were songs that Chris was singing went so much with the message that I felt the Lord gave me. It just made me excited. So I have to slow myself down. Like I said, I don't have a lot of scriptures. Now, when the scripture we just got through reading, it says, when it says peace and safety, then sudden destruction shall come. Now, the first page says major U.S. retailers are closing more than 6,000 stores. This is what prompted me yesterday. I tried to meet with my immediate family for us to pray and seek the Lord about what is it that he would need us to do. Because when we look at what's taking place in Texas, I think Elder Chuck said he had heard it, that enough water has fallen in Texas to put the state of Rhode Island under 10 feet of water. The whole state could be placed under 10 feet of water because of what took place in Texas with the rain. And that could happen at any place, at any time. Earthquakes, storms, tsunamis, anything could happen at any time to take people over. And you could be left with no flashlights, you could be left with no candles, or no water, or no food. Those are just the natural things that people would need to have in a house where you're trying to survive. Everybody needs to have some type of preparedness. Just when I was a kid, in the summer times, my mother used to buy peaches and tomatoes and vegetables, and she would cook them up and can them in a mason jar so that in the wintertime, when grocery stores weren't prevalent then like they are now, so people would prepare in the summertime to survive during the winter. But the Antichrist system has lulled people into a false sense of comfort and security and ease and laziness that we don't think about preparing for difficult times because we think we're always going to be able to go to a grocery store and get the things that we need at any particular time. And people of God should not ought to think that way. People of God ought to always be prepared for whatever comes in the future. That's the way we're supposed to be living when we don't live according to the Antichrist system. So I heard of this article on Friday as what prompted me to try to do what I tried to do. Now I have checked on my paper, I'm going to read some of this to you. It says major U.S. retailers are closing more than 6,000 stores. The U.S. economy really is improving. Then why, if the U.S. economy is really improving, then why are big U.S. retailers permanently shutting down thousands of stores? The retail apocalypse that I have written about so frequently appears to be accelerating. As you will see below, major U.S. retailers have announced that they are closing more than 6,000 locations. But economic conditions in this country are still fairly stable. See, peace and safety. So if this is happening already, what are things going to look like once the next recession strikes? For a long time, I have been pointing to 2015 as a major turning point for the U.S. economy, and I still feel that way. And since I started the Economic Collapse blog at the end of 2009, I have never seen as many indications that we are headed into another major economic downturn as I do right now. If retailers are closing this many stores already, what are your malls or our malls and shopping centers going to look like a few years from now? And then the list, I gave you all the list and I checked some of them off. Chico's, Coach, and the Dollar Tree Family Store, Friendly's Ice Cream, Office Depot, Pet Boy, Pier 1, and the one on the last page everybody knows, Radio Shack, Ruby Tuesday, Sears, Staples, Target went bankrupt in Canada, Walgreens. I mean, everything we've known, the comfort that we've known, when we are so caught up in the things of this world, the comfort of this world, the course of this world, we are living and embracing the Antichrist system. We are a part of the Antichrist system, and we are supposed to come out of that system and be separate so that we don't depend on needing the latest clothes, the latest shoes, the latest purse. But we ought to be preparing and equipping, and all throughout the scriptures to talk about the ant that never sleeps, that the ant prepares for the cold season. The bees, if you pay attention to the birds, the bees, the animals, everything except God's people is doing according to God's standard. Do you understand what I'm saying? Is this making sense to you all so far? And then I had another outline. It's a different different site, but it's saying the same thing. And you who are online or part of the ministry should have got a copy of this. And it says 6,000 stores closing due to Obama retail apocalypse. Major chains imploding. You see, I don't blame this, like this people say, on Barack Obama, because I believe it's the Antichrist system. I know he's part of the system and he's carrying out his assignment. So I look at him doing what somebody else or something else is instructing him to do. Am I making sense? Mm-hmm. All right, let's turn to 1 Peter. Chapter 4. Well, no, I want to start in chapter 2. Thank you, Jesus. 1 Peter chapter 2. And I want to look at verse. Like I told you, this is going to be a short message today because I wanted us to engage. It says in verse 17, honor all men. And I think you should circle love the brotherhood. I think we need to practice loving the brotherhood of Christ. Feel, have reverence for God. Do you see it? Now I want to go to chapter 4. And we're going to start at verse 1. And this is what we got to keep in our hearts. For as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lusts of men, but to the will of God. We ought to all be living according to the will of God, not to please another man or another person or even your own self, but to please God. For the time past of our life, many suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles when we walked in lasciviousness, lust, excess of wine, revelings, banquetings, and abominable idolatries, wherein they think it strange. The people who you used to do these things with now, when you don't do them, they think that it's strange that you run with them to the same excess of riot. That you run not with them to the same excess of riot. And now they speak evil of you because you don't do those things with them anymore. That should be your testimony, and you ought to be dead to that, so that it doesn't bother you anymore. It shouldn't even appeal to you anymore to want to do those things. Do you see it? Who shall give account to him that is ready to judge the quick and the dead? For this cause was the gospel preached also to them that are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the flesh. I'm sorry, in the spirit. But the end of all things, see, we are supposed to live every day as though the end of all things is at hand, because this was written 2,000 years ago, and at the time it was written, the people who believed in Christ, they believed that the end of all things back then was at hand, and it regulated their lives, okay? Therefore, be you sober and watch unto prayer. Prayer is key. Prayer has to become your default. When you see the enemy trying to hinder you, when you see the tribulations, the trials, the afflictions, the things that the enemy sends against you through people, the enemy speaks to you through people and circumstances and situations, and it's meant to make you afraid, to get you off your faith, to get you off track, to get you off center, to get you to lose sight of who Jesus is and how big he is and what he's already done. So you have to get into a mindset that you need to be sober. You need to be alert. You need to watch and pray. You see, the end of all things is at hand. Because the end of all things is at hand, be you therefore sober and watch unto prayer. And above all things, have fervent charity. Y'all need to practice, that means love. You got to practice this. Have it fervent. Fervent means heated, on fire love among yourselves. For love shall cover the multitude of sins. Use hospitality one to another without grudging. As every man has received the gift, even to minister the same one to another, as good stewards to the manifold or the many grace of God. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracle of God. See, we ought to be loving each other. And each one of us is going to have slow days, challenging days. But when we speak, we ought to speak as oracles of God, imparting encouragement, lifting up each other, loving each other, shouldering each other, carrying each other's burdens. That's what God gave us a body for. Am I making sense to you? Don't anyone think because today I'm not having trials or tribulations that I can puff up my chest and raise up my shoulder and act like I'm better than you. That's pride, and it's vanity, and it's not good in the sight of God. It's displeasing to God because it goes against just these verses of scriptures alone. Am I making sense to you? But everybody has to have a prayer life. Everybody has to be sober and watchful to take care of yourselves. But when you find that you're weak, you ought to be able to lean on whoever else is around you that's stronger than you. So today I might need you to be strong for me, and tomorrow you might need to be strong. I might need to be strong for you. We have to be able to be available to each other. Not one person needs to always be weak, and not one person needs to always be the one to be strong. We all need to be doing our best to be strong. But when you find that you can't be, you ought to be able to comfortably take off the mask and be able to lean on other people without feeling ashamed or without putting up a facade. It's time to take the mask off and stop being a hypocrite and superficial and pretentious, because the times is dark and we need to be real. Do you understand what I'm saying to you all today? Hallelujah, Jesus. Verse 11, if any man speak, when you speak, let him speak as the oracle of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God gives. Don't lean on your understanding. Use the word of God to speak and encourage people, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trials, which is to try you. You gotta be tried. As though some strange thing happened unto you. But rejoice inasmuch as you are partakers of Christ's sufferings. Christ's sufferings. Think it not strange when the fiery darts come against you. This is letting you know it's gonna come against you. So when it comes against you, don't think it's strange that when his glory shall be revealed, you may be glad also with exceeding joy. Is this making sense today to you guys? I know you need to be strong, and you need to, when you read the scriptures, when you meditate on the scriptures, when you meditate on how big God is, how strong God is, that God is in control, it should bring you peace to your soul. That's why it is well with my soul today. Am I making sense? All right, then let's go to Matthew, the 25th chapter of Matthew. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Be sober. Be vigilant. Be prayerful. Have a good prayer life. When you pray, you find yourself feeling better. Whatever's coming against you, it pushes back the darkness. The enemy don't want to hear you praise Jesus, exalt Jesus, magnify Jesus, speak the word of God. It's afflicted and tormented to hear that somebody is able to stand on God's word and speak his word with confidence. Matthew 25, I'm excited today. Because I was afflicted this morning. I was tormented this morning. My nose was running to the point where I couldn't hardly breathe. The enemy was coming against me in all different ways. And I stood up and I said, in the name of Jesus Christ, the weapons of my warfare, they are not carnal weapons, but they are mighty through God for the pulling down of stronghold. God did not give me a spirit of fear, but he gave me power and love and soundness of mind. And in the power and authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, I command you to cease and desist your maneuvers against me. I plead the blood of Jesus against you, and my nose just stopped right there. And this is what you have to do. And he's the Lord of the flies. So later on, he came back. And so you have to get into the mode of speaking the Lord's word. I stand on the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. For the weapons of my warfare, they are not carnal. And I just have to repeat it again and stand on the word. Because the word is the sword. And the enemy is going to try you with the fiery darts. But if you're not in the right place with God, you're not going to think to speak the word, because you're going to feel guilty. You're going to feel ashamed. you're going to feel condemned. And the Lord says, there's now therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. So if you're walking after the flesh, you don't have a leg to stand on, because your flesh is no match for the darkness and the perilous times that we are in today. Am I making sense to you? Don't play with God. Don't pretend that you're getting this if you're not. Don't say what you're getting out of this if you're not able to apply it to your life, because the only person who you're deceiving is you. If you're gossiping, if you're lying, if you're defrauding people and committing fornication, you're not living to please God. You're pleasing your flesh, and you're not being led by the Holy Spirit of the living God. And I'm telling you this today. So when you stand before God, whoever hears my voice, you can't pretend to God that God didn't do his job to send somebody who's speaking as an oracle of God what thus says the word of God says. And you have to practice it and live it in order for the power of God to be able to work in your life. Am I making sense to you today? Matthew chapter 25, verse 1. Jesus is speaking to the Jews, and some of the things he's saying to them applies to us. It says, then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. Both people was virgins. Both people was looking for the bridegroom. But 5 was foolish and 5 was wise. They that were foolish took their lamps. They had a lamp, but they didn't have any oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps, because the wise was paying attention, prayerful, alert. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered. The bridegroom was so long in coming, everybody got tired, they slept. At midnight, at the beginning of this year, I gave you all a handout where the scientists set the doomsday clock for 3 minutes before midnight. This is saying at midnight, there was a cry made. Behold, the bridegroom comes. Go you out to meet him. So when the bridegroom comes, is he going to find you like the wise or the foolish? Then all the virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. This is awesome. This is one of those ways, Chris, the Lord was using you. Now look at the second handout with the word trim. There's only one place in the Bible that the word trimmeth. It's in Jeremiah 2. And that's where we were yesterday. After we prayed, I opened the Bible. We opened it to Jeremiah 2, verse 33. Talks about the people who trim their, who's trimming, but they're not really looking for God. So I looked up the word trimming. It says it's only listed one place in the Bible. But look at all of the different ways the word trim can apply. To dress, to decorate, to clip, to lop, as cut off a branch, to make neat. It even applies in carpentry. To rebuke sharply, arrange. Isn't that something? Now I want to read the commentary to you. I have a study Bible. And now I want to go back to scripture, but before I want to read this commentary. It says the Greek word often translated as virgin can also be translated as maiden or young woman. The context of Jesus' parable, the emphasis indicates that these are young, unmarried women, similar to today's bridesmaids. Of the 10 maidens, 5 are prepared and 5 are not. The unprepared are excluded from the marriage feast. So there's a marriage feast that as the bride of Christ, we ought to be preparing ourselves to be partakers of. The connection of the marriage feast with the end times banquet anticipated by Judaism and Christianity is obvious. The disciples who are not prepared will be excluded from the banquet. Why wouldn't the wise maidens lend oil to the foolish maidens? Why not help those in need? The necessities this parable illustrates, and you can write these quickly, personal faith, repentance, baptism, personal holiness, personal service. And I thought this next one is awesome. Personal preparedness can't be borrowed. Personal preparedness can't be borrowed. You can help people, but when it comes down to being prepared personally, you can't borrow that. Now I'm going to go back to the scriptures. Verse 4. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made. Behold, the bridegroom comes. Go you out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. They had the oil that they need to trim their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, give us of your preparedness, your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, not so, lest there be not enough for us. And you, but go you rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they were ready, went in with him. They who were ready went in with him to the marriage. And the door was shut. You better be spiritually prepared. For you see the perilous times. The people who is worshiping Satan is trying to open the portal to the abyss.